Dedication and Preface of the Voyage of the Pox, an Allegory, by Dom Bede Camm, OSB. The Voyage of the Pox, an Allegory. Dedication. To the dear memory of Louis Joseph Arnold, who from childhood gave his heart to God and Saint Benedict, and having worn through life unstained the white robe of his innocence, was in death clothed with the monastic habit, and fell asleep in the peace of Christ, March 8, 1904, at the age of 18 years. R.I.P. End of dedication. Preface. This little story needs perhaps a word of explanation. Really founded on a dream, it was first written to be read aloud to some lads who, under my care, were preparing themselves for the monastic life in our abbey. They took great delight in it, and themselves suggested many additions and improvements to the original story. It was not meant for publication, and truly fulfilled its end by interesting those for whom it was written. But, after lying in a drawer for a good many years, it has been brought to light again, and is now, though with some trepidation, given to a wider circle of readers. Though meant as a picture of the vocation of the few who, in these days, feel drawn to the Benedictine life of prayer and peace, it may possibly interest others who do not share that happiness. Perhaps, indeed, it may help to develop in some young heart the germ of a nascent vocation. I have dedicated it to the memory of one of those for whom it was written, who was never tired of hearing it read, and who is himself portrayed, though he was very far from suspecting it, in one of the leading characters of the story. He was the first of the little band of voyagers to reach the celestial country, the first to see the face of that blessed one whom he loved so tenderly, and in whose habit he was clothed, to his great joy and consolation, but a few days before God called him from us. D.B.C. Erdington Abbey, Birmingham, October 25, 1905. End of preface. Section 1 of The Voyage of the Pox, an Allegory, by Dom Bede Camm, O.P. I fell asleep, and found myself transported to the shores of a vast ocean. The shore stretched before me, an interminable expanse bounded only by the distant horizon, a long stretch of yellow sand backed by a wall of inaccessible cliffs. The sea was calm and blue, and the sun shone brightly on the sparkling waters. Along the beach lay a flotilla of boats of all kinds and sizes, while further off loomed large in the bright haze the outlines of great ships, transports as it seemed. Upon the shore was gathered an immense crowd of people of all ages and classes, all eager to embark. Some were chaffering with boatmen over the price of the passage. Others had taken possession of the rowing boats and were making their way to one of the large ships that lay off the shore. Others were seizing on boats of all kinds, including frail canoes, which seemed as if they might be swamped by the waves in the very moment of leaving the shore. Among the crowd, my eyes rested on a little group of boys. Two of them struck me particularly. They were evidently brothers, and the younger clung to his elder brother's hand, as if half frightened by the uproar. The elder was a tall and graceful youth, with dark curly hair, and deep gray eyes which looked you in the face with a fearlessness and confidence that only innocence can give. He seemed about 15, and his brother, whom he was watching over with a tender care that seemed almost paternal and yet was wholly boyish, must have been about 8. The other two boys who formed the little group formed a contrast to the brothers. One, a tall lad of some 15 years, was very fair, with a sunny face and laughing blue eyes, which were most attractive. His companion pleased me less. He had a sullen expression on his face, and rather shifty look in his eyes, and he was evidently out of humor. He was short and thin, and was probably the oldest member of the little party. His name, as I soon learned, was Symphorian. The boys were bareheaded and clad in a simple white tunic reaching to the knees and leaving their limbs bare. The tunics were girt with a belt, and round their necks hung a golden cross. I went nearer to hear what they were saying. "Why dost thou not heed me, Calixtus?" I heard Symphorian complaining to his fair-haired companion, instead of running all over the shore looking for a boat that must have gone without us, or which has never come at all. Why not take yonder fellow's offer? He says he will row us out to that fine galley yonder, and if size and speed count for anything, we shall reach our journey's end far quicker and more safely than by thine old-fashioned bark. Poor old Symphorian, was the reply, I am so sorry to try thy patience thus. But thou knowest that we were told to look for the boat with Pax upon the prow, and the guide who would bring us safely home. Agathos and Theodore here are going by the same boat, and thou wouldst not like to leave them in the lurch? Come, interrupted Agathos, the elder brother whom we have described, I think our search is at an end. Look, Symphorian, look, Theodore. Look at that large galley yonder with the black banner on which the device we seek is embroidered in golden letters, Pax, and see yon stranger standing by the ship with the long flowing robes and the hood upon his head. Surely this is the guide sent us by the prince. Methinks he has a venerable face and kindly air, and we should do well to join ourselves to him, and I see there are other lads already in his company. And Agathos led the way to a little group standing by the waterside. Welcome, my children, said the voice of the stranger. Will ye embark with me in the good ship Pax? She is a boat that hath made the voyage many thousands of times before, and never has she lost a passenger, save indeed that they left her by their own will, since the day that she was built long years ago. Father, said Agathos, we long to arrive at the Golden City, where our parents wait for us to bring us into the presence of the king. And they told us that we should voyage most securely in a boat that bore the same device as thine. I pray thee, who is the builder and owner of this vessel? It was built, my son, long years ago, by one named Benedict, was the reply. That means blessed, does it not? Interposed Calixtus. Yes, verily, and blessed was he both in name and grace. This ship hath he built.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.